Now let's bring in a man who has some perspective on the matter of banks. Tom Brown of Second Curve Capital. He's a contributing editor here at Bloomberg with his view on Bank of America's numbers. It's a really messy quarter, Tom. You've had a chance to dig through some of the noise. And what do you think on balance? A good quarter, bad quarter for Bank of America, or more of the same?
More of the same. Really not impressive. Credit's getting better. That's the only good thing you can say about the quarter. But $4 billion of charges still for the mortgage mess, that's pretty big.
It's a lot of money, but some people may think it's a good thing because, as Brian Moynihan told me earlier, it gets the GSE issue behind them, which is to say that they've set aside enough money to buy back all the mortgages, or at least, according to their agreement, the mortgages that Fannie and Freddie say they need to buy back.
That's true, but I had lunch yesterday with a board member of one of the four largest mortgage companies, and he was just reminding me that there are eight government agencies that are all going after this mortgage mess, and he expects that his particular company is going to have to pay a fine to each of these eight agencies.
I see. So Bank of America's exposure to these government putback requests may not be over. And furthermore, they're still facing similar requests from the likes of PIMCO, for example, or BlackRock, plus the monoline insurers, the likes of MBIA and AmBank, who also want Bank of America to make good on mortgages they say the bank either underwrote poorly or didn't properly document. So that, I mean, have you any idea how much potential exposure that may mean for Bank of America going forward?
Nobody can really quantify it with any degree of certainty, but I do think we'll look back on the $6+ billion of charges that Bank of America took this year and say that was the peak.
You know, when we came in with that comment from Brian Moynihan, he was responding specifically to one of the questions I asked him about the investment bank. And when you look at the numbers, investment banking, which is to say underwriting and merger and acquisition and restructuring advice, looks pretty good relative to the rest of Wall Street and the other quarters that we saw in 2010. But take trading for a moment, fixed income or equity trading, and Bank of America seems to be running behind the leaders of the pack, which in the case of fixed income is J.P. Morgan, in the case of equities, Goldman Sachs. Is that a problem? Tom Montag seemed to be the guy who could deliver competitive numbers this quarter. Not this time.
What Brian Moynihan would want us to believe is that it was just a bad quarter for them. It was a bad quarter for the industry, but particularly for Bank of America. And, that should be a one-time event.
You believe it will be a one-time event?
Well, that's what they want us to believe.
Of course. Well,
so if we see
a big difference between what they want us to believe and what you believe. What do you think?
I think we're going to see in the first quarter. It should be tough for everybody again in the first quarter, and Bank of America better do better on a relative basis.
One last question before we go, and we have to make it quick. Credit quality. Bank of America has benefited from credit quality, but at a slower pace, or perhaps later than some of its peers. Do you think that's going to change going forward, that as the American economy perhaps picks up speed, it actually may benefit Bank of America more so than the likes of J.P. Morgan and Citigroup?
No, I think you're seeing that credit quality is getting better throughout the industry. That's the biggest driver to earnings for most banks in the United States.
Bank of America's fourth quarter loss was due largely to credit losses in the mortgage business. Provisions there totaled more than $4 billion. Major institutional investors like PIMCO, for example, and BlackRock also say they were sold faulty mortgages by Countrywide, now part of B of A, and they're demanding as well that B of A buy those mortgages back, just like it's buying them back from the GSEs. My colleague Betty Liu took a close look at why the problem perhaps may not be so bad as first thought.
Just last month, Bank of America paid $2.8 billion to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to settle claims its mortgage unit Countrywide sold them risky mortgages. Bank of America did not admit or deny wrongdoing. But private investors like PIMCO and BlackRock, hoping for a similar payout, may be left out. It all boils down to the so-called reps and warranties, or the assurances Countrywide made about the condition of these loans guaranteeing the mortgages. Countrywide loan documents obtained by Bloomberg show that not only do investors have to prove Countrywide misrepresented the quality of the mortgages it sold, but that the mortgage, quote, materially and adversely affects the interests of the certificate holders.
So it's two problems. You got to find the breach, and you got to say the breach is why this mortgage is worth less than we thought it was.
That's key, legal experts say. Was it Countrywide's alleged deception or the fact that housing crashed in 2008 that led to the mortgage losses?
The whole premise of the product sort of was property prices going to keep going up.
And proving deception may be difficult. Our examination of the 115 loan securities that are the subject of attorney Kathy Patrick's investor lawsuit against Bank of America shows how risky the mortgages were. It's listed in this column. Dozens of investment-grade securities, called Alt-A, had so-called liar loans, that is, mortgages underwritten without verifying the income of the homeowner. At least six Alt-A securities were made up of 90% of these liar loans, a fact that was disclosed to investors before they invested in the securities.
Ultimately, it's the buyer's responsibility in these private securitizations, and they're just working as aggressively as they can to try to reduce their losses.
Kathy Patrick's office declined to comment. In the meantime, Bank of America says it has been holding meetings with investors in the lawsuit. I'm Betty Liu, Bloomberg, New York.
We are back now with the man you just saw on screen, Bloomberg contributing editor Tom Brown. He's the CEO of Second Curve Capital. And Tom, Betty's piece there was looking at the at this whole putback issue. Bank of America says it's put the GSE problem, Fannie and Freddie, behind it, but now it's up to BlackRock and PIMCO to see if they can squeeze money out of Bank of America. And it's a critical issue for the bank and its earnings going forward. Do you think they'll be successful?
I think they're going to be successful in the sense that we'll have some sort of a settlement between Bank of America and the other large mortgage issuers and these private companies. But the settlement is going to be small, particularly relative to the settlement with the GSEs.
Now, why is that? Is it because the government can just wield so much more authority and power over a firm like Bank of America, and notwithstanding their size and importance to the market, PIMCO and BlackRock just can't do that?
No, the standards were much easier for the GSEs to put back to the issuers like Bank of America.
I see. That kind of explains it. Tom, thanks very much for being here once again.